Hello and welcome to FS Mania and part one of a new video series featuring Aerosoft's version of the de Havilland DHC-6 Twin Otter. We are currently located in the capital city of Kathmandu, Nepal, population of around 2.5 million people. Kathmandu, which is located in the Kathmandu Valley at an elevation of 4,600 feet, is surrounded by some pretty major mountains. The Kathmandu International Airport, identifier Victor November Kilo Tango, is the one and only international airport in Nepal. So if you want to climb Mount Everest, this is the airport that you will most likely fly into. The Kathmandu scenery I'm using was created by Thai Creations and purchased from Sim Market. Our mission for this series is to fly a group of adventurous mountain climbers from Kathmandu to Lukla Airport, which is high in the Himalayan mountains and very close to Mount Everest, the highest peak in the world. Our aircraft for today's flight is the de Havilland Canada DHC-6 Twin Otter, which is a 19-passenger STOL, short takeoff and landing, utility aircraft originally developed by the de Havilland Canada Company and is currently being manufactured by Viking Air. The Twin Otter is an unpressurized, twin-engine, turbine-powered aircraft ideally suited to operate in all conditions and climates. It can be fitted with floats, skis, or tundra tires and has a very rugged undercarriage for easy maintenance. Development of the Twin Otter began in 1964. The first prototype flight was flown in 1965. The first Series 100 produced was equipped with twin Pratt & Whitney PT6A-20 turboprops rated at 550 shaft horsepower. The aircraft we're flying today, November Niner Alpha Bravo Tango, is a Series 300 variant, which has been the most popular model to date. This aircraft is equipped similar to the vast majority of Twin Otters in terms of avionics. The 300 series, which was first introduced in 1969, is fitted with two Pratt & Whitney PT6A-27s rated at 680 shaft horsepower each. And they feature Hartzell 3-blade reversible pitch constant speed fully feathering propellers that measure 8 foot 6 inches in diameter. The Twin Otter is 50 foot long, has a wingspan of 65 feet, a tail height of 19 feet 6 inches, the average range of 887 nautical miles, and a top cruise speed of 182 knots at 10,000 feet. Service ceiling is 26,700 feet, maximum takeoff weight 12,500 pounds. She will carry 378 gallons of fuel and has an average retail price of $7 million. So, in my opinion, this airplane is well suited for our mission today. So, hop in and let's go flying. Okay, let's get this show on the road. I have checked our weather today. We have mostly clear skies, light winds, and our temperature is a little bit over 40 degrees, and looks like a good day to fly to Lukla. So we have loaded our fuel. We have 800 pounds on board. We have 11 passengers, about 640 pounds of baggage, and our takeoff weight is going to be 10,500 pounds, which is well below our maximum takeoff weight of 12,500. I want to take just a second and show you a flight planning tool that I use a lot. This is from skyvector.com, and what you're looking at is a world VFR chart. They also have world high en route IFR charts and world low en route IFR charts. You can easily access this online. And our flight today is going to be in this area right here in this region. Here's India to the south and China to the north. And this darker area here is the Himalayan mountain range. And these that blue outlined areas, they are actually weather that's being overlaid, sigmets, which is significant meteorological areas that would affect our flight. This is not current with our flight because our flight has already taken place. But so there's a great little flight planning feature about this with this site. If we just come over and click on the little flight plan bar, we can put in our identifiers for our airport, and we're flying from Victor November Kilo Tango. So I'm going to add that to our flight plan, and you'll see it zooms us in to Kathmandu. And this is a VFR. We can change the scale. We can zoom in and zoom out. So I'll zoom us in here, and we can see here's Kathmandu, and it gives us the information, the identifier, the tower frequency, the ATIS frequency, the field elevation, and in meters and in feet. And there's the VOR, Kathmandu VOR. And this is the current frequency. Actually, the one in Flight Simulator is different. We'll deal with that in a few minutes. But so we were going to fly from Kathmandu. We'll put in another waypoint. We are going to actually fly a SID when we depart, but our first en route waypoint is another little airport that is Victor November Papa Lima. So we'll add that, and you'll see it draws us a nice little magenta line to from Kathmandu to Victor November Papa Lima, and it gives us our course and our distance, 66 nautical miles. So then let's add in our next waypoint, which will be Lukla, and that is Victor November Lima Kilo, I believe. Yep, that's right. And you can see then from Faplu that we have another 13 nautical miles to go, and 037 degrees. And Mount Everest is right up in here. It's within this area of significant weather. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe it's right there. We can zoom in pretty tight, and we can see that we have terrain issues. And here's some mountains that are at 11,000 feet. And this area here is a 10,000 foot ridge right here. And if we move on up further to the north, we can see 21,000. There's some 20,000 foot elevations. And if we come on up here, we'll see, let's see if I can find Mount Everest. There is Mount Everest right there. I can see a 27,000. It actually goes on up to 29,000. It's just, there's the peak right there. So my plan is to fly in here to Faplu, or fly to Faplu, and we'll begin a descent. And there's a valley here that goes to that will help us to descend down below these ridges and come in here to Lukla. So that's the plan. And I'll zoom back out here. If you're flying IFR, you can click on the world low, and you can see the airways and the nav aids and the airport. So terrain and other features are left off because in theory you're flying in the clouds, and you don't need to know, see what all's down there. But for VFR flight planning and for flying into mountainous regions, certainly this is a helpful and useful tool. You'll notice these numbers here in each of these areas, this grid, you can see that number there, that number. Those are the minimum safe altitudes to fly in this region. So we're going to be passing through an area where the minimum safe altitude is 24,500 feet. Our flight is planned for 13,500, but the high terrain is up here to the north. We are. I've looked closely at this map. We're just fine at 13.5. That will keep us above any terrain here. Now, if we had to deviate around any weather or anything up here, we'd have to climb up above this altitude to make sure that we didn't hit a mountain. Over here, you can see in this region where Mount Everest is, 29,900 is the highest safe altitude. So that is a great little tool. It's got this flight planning feature. You can also bring in layers and add weather. Right now I've got segments on here, but you can also put add weather radar, satellite infrared, and it will display that over your map as well, and you can see current information in terms of weather. So handy little tool, skyvector.com. I highly recommend it, and it's free, so you can't beat that. So let's just take a second and look at the SID that we're going to be flying today. Now I realize this SID is for an IFR departure, and we are going to be on a VFR flight plan, so we don't necessarily have to fly this SID, and the Twin Otter is certainly capable of climbing out of Kathmandu and clearing the terrain. But I just am doing this because I think it's just a good exercise to fly the procedure, and particularly this one has a DME arc, and you don't really fly those very often in the real world, and so it's just good to practice, because if you ever do get one, you don't have to accept it if you do, but from an air traffic controller, but if you do get one, it's nice to be able to accept it and to fly it, and so we're going to be doing that today. So you can see here, this is the egress SID, and we're actually going to be flying the Egress 1B, and the description is down here on the bottom. And the 1B designates that we'll be departing from runway 02. And the SID is telling us to climb straight ahead to the Kilo Tango Mike 2.5 DME. And so we're going to depart from runway 2, heading this way, and there's the 2.5 DME arc from the VOR right here, Kilo Tango Mike VOR. One note, this frequency that's on the SID for the VOR 113.2 is as of the date of the publication of this chart, which is March of 2011. If you use that frequency, at least on my flight simulator, it will not bring up the VOR, because on an older chart that I also had, which was dated 07, the frequency for the Kathmandu VOR was 112.3, and that's the frequency that actually worked. And so I don't know, that's not been updated for some reason in my nav database, but so that's the frequency that I actually ended up plugging in, but everything else was still the same. This procedure has been updated. There was a different identifier out here that was decommissioned later. So at any rate, we're going to take off and fly runway heading to the 2.5 DME point, and then we're going to, according to the routing, we're going to turn left and remain within 5 DME of the VOR. And there's the 5 DME arc. Now, it doesn't say we have to fly the 5 DME arc. It doesn't say we have to fly any arc. It just says to remain within the 5 DME. So we're going to do that, and we're going to actually fly an arc, though, and I'm going to use a technique to do that. And we're going to continue and turn and fly this arc all the way until we reach the 320 radial of the VOR, and at that point then we can turn inbound and fly direct to the VOR. Once we reach the VOR, then we are to fly outbound on the 105 radial to egress, which is 15 DME from the VOR, and we are to continue our climb to the MEA, which is the minimum en route altitude, and in our case that'll be 13,500 feet. Once we reach egress, then we can proceed. These are airways, or taking you to intersections, which will put you on airways, but we are flying VFR, and we will proceed from this point direct to our first en route waypoint, which is Vaplu. So that's the SID. That's the procedure that we're going to be flying. Although it's not necessary on this day, we will use it for just a training exercise. Okay. We have filed a VFR flight plan, and basically I have gone over our routing. And so let's just get our checklist started. Our cabin doors are closed and latched. Seat belts and shoulder harnesses fastened and adjusted. Control lock removed. And we'll just click here. I do want to say something about the checklist on this airplane. You can use your shift to, and you can bring up a handy little checklist. And it lets you configure the airplane in various configurations. And you have your checklist, and you can come in, and when you do an item, you can click it off, or you can right click it and it will actually do the item for you. So this is a very good way to learn the airplane. I do my own variations of these checklists. I take some things out and add some things. I take out some of this stuff here, for example, cross-checking the booster pumps and the emergency pumps check and so forth. I take out some of that. It's a good idea to do those things. Obviously, you would on a real airplane, but for the sake of the video, I don't want to cause it to be too long, so I'll just eliminate some of those things. But if you're flying the airplane, by all means, do those so that you can learn the systems and use the checklist. But my checklist will be somewhat abbreviated from this. We'll close that. And but it'll take care of all the essential items for sure. And all of those systems, I can assure you, are going to work. The booster pump, the auto feather, etc. So our parking brake is set. Double check that. Yes, it is. Reset it. Our cabin lighting, we want to get that set up. And basically what we want to do is get our belts, seat belt sign, our no smoking sign. I'll go ahead, since we're up here, and cut on our beacon. Now, we don't have any power on the airplane yet, but once we put it on, the beacon and the position lights will be on. So that's a good thing. That's what we want. And while we're kind of up here, this flap handle is in the up position. Our fuel is not in the off position. So let's bring them back. Now, I've got a brand new Satec X55 Rhino throttle and joystick, and I am still learning how to use it. So any mistakes I make today, I'll blame it on that. But that's our prop levers. So I've got a I've mapped out some of the switches and knobs on my throttle to be able to take care of that. And so hopefully that will, we'll just be sure we're in the idle detent. And I'll tell you this, that on this airplane, if you're going to fly it, you need to program your joystick, your controls, so that you can come into the reverse, the beta range of the prop. And then you need a little bit of a dead zone in here where the idle detent is, and then you can bring it up to max. But we will want that in the idle position, so we'll put it right there. And power levers, flight idle, okay. DC master on, battery on. Let's take a look at the battery voltage. Is well over the minimum required of 18 volts, and that's good. Our caution lights, these are the lights that we would expect to be on without the engine running. We can do a test up here on our caution light. Right click, you'll see these come on, and all of the lights, caution lights, will light up. Advisory lights all over the panel, so that's a good test to be sure you don't have a burnout bulb. So we'll just take that off a test now, put it back on bright. You can dim that at night. And next item on the checklist is, sorry, I lost my place. Gosh, a fire detection test. So let's do a fire detection test. Now, this is going to be loud. I'm just going to go ahead and pre-warn you. I can mute that. right there. So we've effectively tested the bell and the mute. So we'll want to shut that off. Okay, that was pretty loud. That's working, and it will certainly get your attention. And our fuel quantity, let's just take a look and see. We should have 800 gallons, and I can see in both tanks, their center tanks, the wing tanks actually are down. If I can get where I can move this gigantic yoke out of the way. There's the wing tanks. They are empty. We're not carrying too much fuel. We're 800 pounds is actually 300 pounds more than we need. Just nothing wrong with having a little extra fuel on board, as long as we're underweight, which we are. So there's a test for the fuel quantity indicators, and it is right here. That will take them down to zero. So that's working. And our brake and hydraulic pressure is over here. It should be between 1300 and 1600, which it is, PSI. And our booster pumps forward and aft. So we're going to cut these on. Right now you can see that we have lights that are indicating that the pressure is, there's no pressure. So we're going to cut those on. And the left-hand side went out, and cut that one on, the forward pumps, and the right hand side went out. So I want to just clear the area. We're getting ready to start our engine. So I want to make sure, let's jump over here in our co-pilot seat real fast, and I don't see anybody out there. That's good. So we'll go ahead and start our engine. Now what we're going to do when we do this is we're going to want to monitor our T5, which are our temperature gauges for our engine, that they do not come over here into the red line, which I believe is 725 degrees Celsius. We do not want them in there. If they do, we're going to cut the fuel off and avoid burning up our engine. We're also going to look at our NG gauge, which is our gas generator, and once it gets up above 12%, then we're going to add fuel. Now, I have on my Satech X55, I have mapped a couple of rotary knobs to the fuel, so I'll be able to add that without having to reach back up here to do it. So we're going to start the right engine by right clicking, then we're going to watch our NG come up. There's 12%. I added the fuel in. T5 did not spike. The torque is coming up, the props are spooling up, everything is looking good there. Be sure I did not get that fuel all the way turned on, so I want to do that. And now we can start the left engine. We did not look at the oil pressure. That's something else, and as it's spooling up, we can watch that oil pressure gauge coming up here. It is in the green, so we're good now to start the left engine. There's 12%. We're adding fuel. Oil pressure's coming up. T5 is staying in the green. Prop spinning up. We have two good starts. After start, I know I need to. One thing for certain is let's go ahead and get our generators on. Reset each one as we cut it on. That's good. And now we're going to cut on our avionics. There is no avionics master on this airplane, so you just got to cut them each one on. I don't know why. It seems like that would have been a good idea. But so we have our DME, our ADF, which we're probably not going to use on this flight, but we'll cut it on anyway. Transponder. And go ahead and set our squawk code in that we got when we called to get our clearance. 0316. We're on standby there. And let's go ahead and set up our radios. So, the first thing we want to do is get our ATIS dialed in ATIS at Kathmandu is, the frequency is 127.0. So let's dial that in on COM 1. And we'll listen to the robot tell us what's going on.
Kathmandu, airport information, Papa 00200, wind calm, visibility greater than 20 miles, sky conditions, few clouds at 1,400, temperature 62. Minus 4, altimeter 2, 9, 9, 2, visual, runway 2 in use, landing and departing, runway 2, VFR aircraft, stay direction of flight, all aircraft read back short instructions, advise controller on initial contact, you have Papa. Kathmandu, airport information, Papa.
So it's Papa.
Zulu, wind calm, visibility greater than 20 miles, sky condition, few clouds at 1,000.
We'll go ahead and shut him up. We have Papa, and they are using runway 2 today. And I want to, I've got ground control now here in COM 2, so I really need to flip over there to COM 2. That's in, so we can transmit call ground when we get ready to leave. I've programmed in the tower frequency 118.1 and the departure frequency is 125.1, so let's get that programmed in. So we'll have all of our communication frequencies that we need put in. 125.1, yes, that is correct. So that's in there. So when we get ready, we'll just switch over, use COM 1, but we'll leave here. Now our VOR that we're gonna want to tune in is Kathmandu Kilo Mike Tango. The frequency for that, I'm looking at my notes, it is 112.3. Now the newer charts, it's changed, but in flight simulator, at least on mine, it's not. So we're going to use the 112.3 and we'll bring it up and identify it. Let me put it in both navs. I'm going to start with nav 1, and actually I'm closer there, so I'll use that one. 112.3, there's 3 112. Now we should see the identifier come up. And we can identify that just by coming over here, and we'll use the audio panel and cut on the volume. We should hear a tone, and I'll set it up in this radio too. There it is. And so let's go ahead and put it in here. 112.3. Let's identify on that one as well. Listen for it on COM 2. So we're 1.8 miles from the station. There it is. So we've identified those. Now we want to set up our radio. And what we're going to do is we're going to set up on nav, the OBS for nav 2. We're going to set that up to the 360 radio. That's the first one we want to identify. And then we're just going to track around to the 320 radial, and then we're going to fly inbound on the probably the 310. So the reciprocal of that is 130. So I want to set this one up over here to 130, and that is now set. Let's just set our heading bug while we're here on the runway heading of about 022, and our altitude window loud beep. We are going to set on our cruise altitude 13,500 for an eastbound flight, which should give us good terrain clearance on our route. I'm sorry, I went past it. There we go. So that is now set. And let's just refer back to the checklist and see what we've done. We have checked the ATIS, the transponder, set the assigned squawk code. We have our COM frequency set for departure. Our nav frequency and radials are set and identified. GPS, we did not set in a waypoint or GPS. So we are flying to egress intersection. I can use the DME to identify that. It's 15 DME from Kilo Mike Tango. So I'm going to go ahead and set in the next waypoint, and let's get over here where we can see it, which will be direct. Let's go direct. There we go. And we want to go to Victor. Let me double check that. It is Victor, November, Papa, Lima, Fatplu. I'd have no idea how to pronounce it. I'm just doing the best I can for an American Southern boy. So, Victor, November. Papa. Victor, November. Papa Lima. There it is. So we'll go ahead and set that in here. We've got our CDI set up on our VOR, VLUC. So, VLUC, so that's what we want there. And we're 66 miles away from that. We're not gonna go direct. We are gonna fly the SID because of these mountains that surround the airport, to be sure we have enough altitude, number one, and number two, because I want to. So, back to our checklist. Our altimeter is set on 29992. Our heading is about 07 something, and that's close there, so it looks like the gyros are set. And let's go ahead and call ground control. Kathmandu ground, Twin Otter, Niner November, Alpha Bravo Tango. We're at the ramp ready to taxi. So we'll just pretend that he called us back, Twin Otter November 9, Twin Otter Niner November Alpha Bravo Tango, taxi to runway 2 via taxiway Alpha. So that's our clearance, that's what we need, we'll confirm it. Alpha Bravo Tango, taxi to runway 2. And so let's just cut on then our taxi light, way up here, there it is. And release our parking brake, and we're good to go. Sun's coming up over the mountains. Beautiful day in Nepal. I am still learning how to use my X-55, and this airplane is extremely hard to taxi with the turbine engine because you have to let them spool up. Getting them set just right is kind of difficult. So the operating manual says to use the prop levers to, it's easier, there's quicker response, etc., etc. But I've not been able to really do that very well. I just have to work the best I can with the power, and it's not easy. So if somebody can figure out how to do it better, that's great. But I know that once I get the airplane rolling, then I could just ease back. It'll, as long as I don't come back too far and ease the power back, it'll continue to roll, and then I can just concentrate on tracking the center line. But yeah, I can move the prop levers just fine with my controller, but it doesn't really seem to affect the taxi speed much. Just to test that theory out, there it is. So, again, let's make sure we stay on the center here. I'm moving them, you know, and nothing really happens. It's just, maybe it's because it's a low RPM setting, I don't know. I expect in the real airplane that is the proper way and the better way to taxi the airplane. But since, I can feather them, and it doesn't really even seem to, now that is actually, maybe that is the better way, let's just see. So we're pretty close back to being feathered. I just haven't really quite figured out on the knob which way to turn it to advance. that way, so it's actually kind of counterintuitive. It's counterclockwise to advance it, clockwise to decrease it. I could change that, maybe. So I'm all the way feathered now. You would think that the aircraft would stop, but not really, so I'm eased the power back into the idle position. There's the whole short line. Hit the brakes. And let me make sure we are, in fact, in idle. There we are. And those props are all the way feathered. We'll bring them back up to full. Let's set the brake here, and we'll do our before takeoff checklist. So we've already put our prop levers in the full forward position, maximum RPM. And if I pull the power back, we should see the beta light come on. We do. So that's telling us right there we're in beta. That's correct. And we want to cut on our auto feather and check our flight controls, free and correct. Not sure if you can see the ailerons from the pilot's seat. I don't think so. So we're going to trust that they're correct. We'll know very soon if they're not. Trim tabs. So I have a, let's get this out of the way. I have a electric trim wheel on my yoke, electric trim lever. So I can't really on this tell very easily. You can see that's trimming the nose down. There's the indicator. That's trimming it up. I guess this is actually the indicator that's moving. So slightly nose up, we'll see how that does. Also, I think it's a good idea on this airplane to put in some rudder trim. Actually, it says takeoff there. I can then zero it out with a switch on, one of the many switches on the yoke. If I just don't forget on the joystick to do it, should actually include that in my modified checklist. Okay, so we have trim tabs set and our flaps. We want to set those for takeoff. So one notch, 10 degrees. That's good. And our pitot heat needs to be on always. Anytime we take the runway, we leave that on all the time. Doesn't matter what temperature it is. We won't use any other ice protection, which is all here today, because we're well above freezing. We have no visible moisture. And our transponder, let's go ahead and set that now to altitude. And we can go ahead and call the tower and see if we can get a clearance to take off. So we're going to need to get back over to COM 1. We can go ahead now and quit monitoring 2. I haven't heard a bit of traffic on this frequency, so who knows? I don't see any other traffic around. Kathmandu Tower, Twin Otter, Niner November, Alpha Bravo Tango at runway 2, ready to go. So we'll just assume they have called us back and said, Twin Otter, Niner November, Alpha Bravo Tango, winds calm, runway 2, cleared for takeoff. Cleared for takeoff, Niner November, Alpha Bravo Tango. So that's after you've identified yourself on the initial call, you certainly can shorten to Alpha Bravo Tango, and now they know who you are. So strobes are on, park and brake. Released, and we'll take the active. little herky-jerky. It's kind of just like a flight simulator is deciding to slow up. Hopefully that'll improve. I believe it will. Okay, looking at our HSI, see we're on 020, and that's what we want. I'm gonna hold our brakes and advance to takeoff power, which is 50 PSI torque. And I can see, I don't want to get above that. I can see we have armed our auto feather. That's a good power setting. Brakes released. Track the center line, airspeed's alive. 60 knots, 70 knots. Pull the nose up. Flaps up. Just pull that prop back to 91%. We're looking for 2.5 miles on the DME before we start our turn. I'll see if we can use our heading bug to. The only thing about this autopilot is that all I really want it to do is track the heading bug, but it seems to decide to trim the nose of the airplane. There's our heading, so we want to go ahead, our DME, we want to go ahead now and turn to our initial intercept heading, which is, I believe, 270. Yes. 270, so let's bring it on around. Just gonna make sure we do not exceed 5 miles on the DME. Go ahead and cut off our auto feather. Engage our yaw damper, we should have done that. So I'm pushing forward on the yoke and the autopilot's fighting me. I have not. Now we're waiting for this needle to center up and then we will begin to fly the arc. 3.3 miles from the station. The needle is basically centered. So we're gonna go ahead and go to 350 and then turn left to 260. So let's just get in here a little closer where we can see these gauges, these instruments. And when it centers, I don't like this much nose up, but I can try to trim it. The autopilot fights me. There we are. So we'll just go 340 and 260. So we just do 10 degree increments, flying the radial, staying within the 5 mile. We're not flying an actual distance from the VOR, we just have to remain within the 5 so we can stay closer, and we are. And we'll go to 330, 240, and then at 320 we're gonna turn inbound to the station. So when we cross this one, 320, then we're gonna switch over here and center up this needle and track inbound. So once we cross the 320 radial, then we're good over here. So then we can just, from that point then, go ahead and let's just center up this needle, So, heading of about 130, we'll go ahead and start going over there. And once we get turned, we'll center up that needle and track. I'll use the nav function to do that. We're 3 miles away. So, tracking inbound on about the 130 radial. And let's just hit nav and let it track inbound for us. We're coming up on 12,000 feet. And then once we get to the station, we're going to track outbound on the 105 radial. So I'll go ahead and put the heading bug over there in preparation for a turn. And we'll just keep an eye when the flag points behind us, we'll know we've passed the station. And so I'm actually going to cut this off. Just hold that heading, but I'm going to drop this nose down, see if I can get us trimmed better. Actually, I need to put in some trim here. There, we passed the station, so we're going to go ahead and turn outbound, get that nose down. Pick up the 105, and we can move that over. There's our heading. Really having to fight the trim on this thing. That autopilot just ran away with it. So that caused me to bust my altitude a little bit, but we'll get back down there. And let's get this over here to the 105. And now would be a good time to engage nav and altitude. And let's see if it'll capture everything and fly it nice for us. We're 2 miles from the station. We're a little high on the altitude, but within tolerance for right now. We can adjust that and tweak it later once everything kind of calms down here. And while that's working, let's go ahead and cut our landing lights off. Let's cut off our taxi light. And since we're at our cruise altitude, we'll let the passengers relax for a moment. So, we flew the SID reasonably well, other than the trouble with this autopilot is it just doesn't want to cooperate on the altitude, and it fights me on the trim. I don't know if there's something I'm doing wrong. If anybody knows, please let me know. I need to probably read the manual a little bit more. But I've not had good luck. I mean, it will hold an altitude once you get there, but it doesn't want to. When I don't have the altitude mode selected, it still tends to try to fight me, and so it doesn't let me trim the nose up or down. So let me just double check our speed, and actually our power setting is just a little bit low. I'm going to bring it on up to the cruise setting of about 41 psi turbine on the turbine torque gauge. And so we're tracking outbound now. Let's make sure we are set up on the 105. It's pretty close to that. And we are 9-10 DME from the POR. So when we get to 15, that will be egress intersection. And then from there we can proceed direct to our next waypoint, which is Baplu Airport. And then from there we will descend down into Lukla. We'll get us turn. We're picking up some turbulence. Not surprising on even a day with light winds with these mountains around. Some of these mountains are just in this area are up around 11 and 12,000 feet, which is why I'm flying at 13.5. If we were flying further to the north, we'd have to be even higher. This terrain is goes on up, and of course Everest is back over here. Somewhere back over in here, maybe that's potentially it there. Seems about right. I would imagine that might be it. Although it could be this one back here. Not sure. We're gonna go there, so just stay tuned. There's our 15 DME. So now we can just go ahead and go direct to, and we'll say yes we do, and let's change that to the GPS. We just flipped it and we're still in the nav mode, and therefore it will track and take us to our next waypoint, and that is 50 miles away. We have a ground speed of 222 knots, which is very good. That will take us a few minutes though, and rather than boring you with the en route segment, I will just end part one right here, and we'll come back in part two. We'll be 15 miles or so before our top of descent. We'll come back and descend into Lukla and hopefully land. So with that, I'll sign off from FS Mania. Thanks for watching and have a good one.